chilling. More like pissing in your fucking faces. This sucks the biggest ass since the Big Bang. I mean, you have absolutely no indication of which door to go through unless you try each and every one of them till the sunshine pops out of your asshole. By God, who the fuck play tested this? Take this, you mummy fucker. By God, everybody stay tuned and see what the fuck happens.
It starts.
Originally, I was gonna give everyone a big treat. A top 10 worst beat-em-up and fighting games, in my opinion. But time does not wait, so I have to scrap the idea and speed up my process. BB Kids! The first thing that really kicks me in the nuts is the music.
Hey yo! BB Kids!
Oh God, is it annoying. The first impression is that these kids are either on crack or drugs. I don't know what you pick. So here you pick your characters, but there's just one thing I'm wondering. Why didn't they put a two-player system in this? I mean, you got two fucking characters. Put a two-player system in it. At least make it better.
Please observe the rules while in Fun World.
More like,
please observe the rules while in Hell.
Enjoy your stay.
Ooh, sounds like a challenge. I wonder is there anything that I will enjoy while I'm at this dump. Okay, we start the level. And one thing to mention is that every time you finish a stage, you always start near the entrance area. And it sucks fuck not from a duck this time. It sucks fuck from two ducks. Oh, and the controls, they are just wonderful. It's so fucking crippled. It responds so slow to my commands. And the jumping, oh, the jumping works just as well. You can't jump up or down, you can only jump left to right, and that's about it. And the fighting sucks, no doubt, because for some reason, if you try to punch or kick these assholes to death, it takes way too fucking long. And since we have a time limit, that makes it even worse. So what do? We hold the R button and then attack. This will let us upper chop these assholes faster in at least 3 hits. You can also do a flying kick, but the problem is, 2 out of 5 chances you might miss because of how crippled this fucking game is. And when you pick up items like this basketball, you're wondering how the fuck do you use it, right? Guess what? We hold the R button again and press the jump button. Then we're allowed to use the item. Or more like throw them. Any item he picks up, he throws it. Oh yeah, and that little spin I did right there, you can only do it if you have full health. So you hold the R button again and press the A button. So we finished level 1, yay! Let's move on.
Where'd Pee-wee go, motherfucker?
Ain't saying jack shit, motherfucker.
Doesn't anyone get the vibe that he was trying to say jack shit, except he didn't? Yeah, I thought so. Okay, at this part, the game has to fucking trick you to extend the game. You would not know what the hell you're supposed to do here. What's everybody's first impression? Save Pee-wee? I mean, in the previous screen it said, where'd Pee-wee go? And your character says, I ain't telling jack shit, meaning he's trying to defend him. So we all assumed that we're supposed to save the baby. But no! We're supposed to break fucking glasses. But how'd you know that? Well, to be honest, it did kind of give it to you in a way, but just not that obvious. Look up into the corner to your left. That's how I figured out what you were supposed to do. Fucked up, eh? So we go through another entrance. There's nothing new except that the hag can now throw candy bars at you and it hurts you. We're still being chased by Men in Black from episode 3. And I'm just gonna be cutting all this crap out because it sucks. It's boring. There's nothing different. Although occasionally you might get attacked by a dog. Okay, the haunted house. It's the biggest fucking nutcracker I have to deal with.
This man out from the security guards in here.
You know, I'm gonna fucking kill you for suggesting that. because the haunted house is the hardest and most difficult and piss poor level ever. And that's the only thing scary about this haunted house. It's piss poor. It's actually a big fucking maze. Why do you have to put a fucking maze in a beat-em-up game? Do it for an adventure game. Don't do it on beat-em-up games. I mean, fuck. Now, in order to find the exit, you see that thermometer up on the top? Yeah. The warmer it gets, it turns red. Until you can find the exit. And also, finding the right doors is a big problem because they don't even give a tiny bit of indication to tell you which door is the right one. You just have to basically guess each and every one of them and make mistakes and memorize them. Oh, and also, you notice that bookcase? Yeah. The only reason it took me so long to find the exit was because there was actually two doorways in the bookcase. One to the left and one to the right. I didn't know that. I thought there was only one path, and I'm like stuck like fuck. And I'm not gonna show you how shitty it is. If you really wanna see how shitty it is, just go test it yourself. Although people who have played BB Kids before and made it here, you will know what I mean. It sucks. So for the love of God, I found the exit. It wasn't fun at all either, considering you also had a time limit. Okay, so we go through another entrance, and I just skip this. Transition effect! So we get into the pirate ship, and thank God it's not a fucking maze again. What you say, crew? Are you down to take them on? Wait, didn't they just enter a fucking pirate ship, and now they're outside? Never mind. Either way, yeah, it's not a maze anymore. We're just going to beat up pirate hookers and that stupid fucking green bird, which is a parrot. And I skip more of this. Transition effect! I forgot to mention, you don't die in pits. They just lead you to other areas. So, here's our first boss fight. Oh, pancakes! I forgot! Crippled fucking controls! I have absolutely no idea how you can beat him effectively. All I can say is avoid him, because the moment he touches you, he will continuously stick that hook up your ass and wave you around until your nuts drop, and then he cracks them, fries them, eats them. So we eventually beat the mama hooker, and you find out that he's a robot. And that the whole place is made by robots. You find Pee-wee, don't know how the hell he got there. And onward to the next level. So next level, I have no idea where the hell we are. It makes me think of Frankenstein's place, but you decide what the hell this place is. Either way, we have new enemies, and they piss you off even more. And as we move on, we eventually get to the end of the level. There is no boss for this level. They only have two bosses, which is good. The bad news is that the bosses have almost no effective strategy against them. Basically, it's just, I hit you, you hit me, eventually I'll kill you too. And yeah, there's no strategy against them. If anyone has one, please tell me. Because I beat it the hard way. And now that I mention, I only lost once in this game. So I make it to the last stage. At last. Stage to end all horseshit produced by this game. You've attacked our robots. You will be punished by having your dicks pulled off. This level, you're in a cave and you're fighting these robot magicians that can shoot magic at you. Which is kind of odd because I don't remember technology being able to use magic. Either way, you kick their ass and eventually you make it to the end of the level, you fight the big fucking robot and he's twice as hard as the pirate robot. Eventually you'll knock his dickhead off and then you still gotta fight him. So we eventually beat him, at last. Stupid metal fucking bitch. And that's the end of the game. Oh, wait, I forgot, the ending. Let's see. Just name it hell, goddammit. Because this is what the game is.
Pee-wee, don't!
That's your ending right there.
couldn't have said, congratulations, you dumb fuck. You just wasted your time playing this game. There you have it, BB Kids for the Super Nintendo. The gameplay sucks fudge because all you're doing is punching people and doing the exact same thing going on a side scroller. The music and sound effects also suck. The graphics, oh my god, I actually got a 1. And the controls are fucking cheese. The fun factor doesn't even exist. It's a load of fuck factor. You'd rather eat a piece of shit than play this piece of shit.
There have been many cheap cash-ins of popular sports figures in video gaming. I bet everyone remembers Todd Bertuzzi's Punch-Out. Or how about the 8-bit classic Buckner's Revenge? And who could forget the ever-infamous Randy Johnson's Pigeon Killer? Yes, there were some pretty offbeat titles based on sports figures. It's the best 1-2 punch since Emos and Razor Blades. But there's one guy that takes the cake for this sort of thing. Shaquille O'Neal. Living proof that waiting in the key for rebounds is rewarded with a lucrative career outside of sports. Seriously, you couldn't get away from Shaq in the mid-90s. He was the closest thing to God. He was on video game covers. He starred in several high-profile movies. He was even a god-awful rap artist that had a double platinum record. Shaq's urine sample would have probably sold for 6 figures back then. The fact was that if Shaq's presence was on something, it would sell like hotcakes, extra hot, caked with hotcake sauce in hotcake land during a hotcake famine. Hence is where the ultimate orgasm of product placement and cheap cash-ins collided. Shaq Fu. Based on the real-life adventures of Dennis Rodman, Shaq Fu is a rather creative name, even if it does sound really stupid. This game is the poster child for overhyped, mediocre licensed products, the Hard Rock Cafe of video games, so to speak. Don't be fooled by the fact that Delphine Software developed this game. It sucks like a whore. If you want an example of how incompetent this game is, just look at the plot. One day, Shaq is walking around the urban wasteland known as downtown Tokyo when he desires to become Todd Pennington and renovate this old karate dojo into a mega mansion. And you've just got to love the blatant Pepsi advertisements that destroy any sense of aura that the game may have had. Okay, so he renters this random karate dojo to tell the owner that he'll tear down these walls, but Mr. Miyagi tells him that he is the one that the stars foretold. Pfft, more like some half-assed excuse that he just finished watching Kazam on the Stars Network. Mr. Miyagi then explains that he needs to go to another dimension to save Daniel-san from the evil clutches of a generic villain. You can just feel yourself getting sucked into the plotline now. More than likely, Shaq got fooled to thinking that the door would allow him to garner rapping talent. Now you're stuck with Shaq, in his basketball uniform of all things, in this wasteland called the Second World. Looks better than Cleveland, though. Let's just call it Jumanji. You might be wondering what surprises Jumanji has in store for Shaq. Waiting until the dice read 5 or 8, perhaps? No. You're stuck with taunting. Why do we need taunting in this game? Yes, taunting can be effective if done properly, but this game makes it so laughable that it gives Chad Warden street cred! Couldn't they have just laughed at how Shaq is in his friggin' basketball uniform? No. You're stuck with dialogue like, "Your magic can't help me, girlfriend."
"But magic has never lost a match, and I'm not your girlfriend."
"And you call yourself Diesel?" "Good one!" "Shaq Diesel." And in some cases, Shaq sells out with a blatant PSA for the Ann Coulter School of Journalism. "We're gonna 5 cent run the bar!" Honestly, this would have been more intimidating. And I know what you're thinking. Dr. Phil got burned. The endings of a fight are much better.
But the Colonel will teach you a lesson, fool.
So, Colonel Sanders is going to eat a bucket of fried chicken in front of Shaq, or what? Of course, you probably could have figured out you were going to laugh your ass off by checking out the title cover. I've always wondered why Shaq hasn't tried to become a comedian. The opponents that you will face are of generic fare, such as Baraka the Rapper, Shark's gang member, Double Charred Soylent Green, this thing? What happens when Motaro rapes Zangief? And what would a fighting game be without generic hot woman that overconfident game developers want 14-year-olds to beat off to? And before you get in a fit of rage, they made one for the furries as well. But what kind of fighting game would this be without fighting? With a game of this prestige, you'd expect the fighting to be superb. But like a Shaquille O'Neal free throw, this fails miserably. Where do I begin? Your opponents seem to do nothing but powerful, long-range attacks. Must be because of Shaq's uniform. I mean, think of the stench! Shaq's big challenge, changing in a locker room. This is a big problem for Shaq, who only knows the sacred martial arts form known as, get ready, Shaquito, the deadliest form of martial arts since the chicken dance. But don't fret just yet, for he has a secret weapon, the aptly named Shaquriken. Good God. That's the most original move I've ever seen in my life! Delphine Software didn't waste any creative expense whatsoever, because this move is so sick it makes me wanna puke! But all the originality of the move is ruined by one thing. It does nothing! Congrats, Shaq. The powers of Shaquito found a way to tickle your opponents with the finest airs this side of the Pacific Ocean. You've also got the Inferno Kick and Inferno Punch, which are useful, if you can ever get them to work. Now that you know your special attacks are useless, all you can do is what Shaq is famous for, out-muscling your opponents in close range. 10 points for realism! Even then, it's no guarantee. Your opponents will cheap-shot you at the simple fact that Shaq takes his sweet-ass time to execute a move. If this is the best fighter Mr. Miyagi can find, that boy is fucked. But fret not, for the strategies that you can go by to save Nezu are unrivaled in depth. All you have to do is kick your opponent back into a corner and keep tapping the C button until he dies. So much for the other fighters' lives of dynamic gameplay. This one gives them a dose of Shaq Diesel. You wanna fight? Come fight me. I hit you with the wild one. I'm like, oh, see, I get dirty at the dark. Got you like Spielberg. You get your ass kicked in the park. You don't believe me. The proof is in the pudding. Been a boy in the hood way before Cuba Gooding. I'm flip strip with the mad Paul style freeze. Music, please. I dribble around like basketballums. People call me 18.
What's that, man?
Extra tallums. You're better than Shaq Tech. Fool, shut up, liar. I lean on a Statue of Liberty when I get tired. Then I punch her in the stomach, I don't give a heck.
Hey, yo, why you pull the hooker like that?
Yo, she beats on my neck. People walk around like, yo, they get charged. But I'm big like a gorilla. 6'7", long. I kick rhymes like New York Kwan do. I smoke the mic like Cheech and Chong do. You don't like Shaq Strictly, I don't give a damn. I know I got skills, man. I know I got skills, man.
Okay, one more second of that tripe and I'm gonna kill myself.
By the end of the first island, you get to take on this guy who appears to be the Asian version of Mr. Clean. This guy is tough, mainly because the developers decided they wanted a poor man Shang Tsung. I also want you to take a look at the upper right and left-hand corners of the screen, especially at the end of a fight. No, wait, it gets better. Hold on. Oh, shit. Oh God, this is hilarious. And you kick the shit out of this guy. He tells you to save his grandson. Wait, time out. If they want me to believe this story, why in the blue hell am I fighting the old guy from the dojo? Jesus Christ, pitching for the New York Yankees is more believable than this. Hey, I've got a brilliant idea, Delphine. Let's get Wilt Chamberlain to get it on Marvin Gaye style with the female fighters while we're at it. At least that's more realistic than fighting Mr. Clean. What's next? Will I have to fight the kid too? Good God! When you thought this plot couldn't get more convoluted, you get to fight Frodo Baggins. Apparently, Daniel-san is eating his heart out at Country Kitchen Buffet, so he couldn't be reached. And you ripped the one ring off of his index finger, and he counters by calling you Charles Barkley. He's right, too. The main character looks more like Sir Charles than Shaq Diesel. What failure! After executing aggravated assault on a minor, you get to take on the thing I was mentioning earlier. The aptly named Beast. And if you think that name stuck, check out the main boss. You have got to be kidding me! The final boss is some pathetic bastard child of Shao Kahn and a Road Warriors cosplayer. What an insult! And notice how Shaq is telling him to release the kid, when he already did so. But if Shaq doesn't beat Seth Raw, he'll take over the world, or some shit like that. Could this statement be any more uninspired? His genericness sickens me. Man the C button! Oh, I forgot to tell you. There's a new level of cheapness with this final boss. Unlike past enemies, Seth Ra will pull special moves out of his ass on a consistent basis. It's like asking Shaq to guard Steve Nash for 20 minutes. It's not happening. I'd also like to note that this is on the easy difficulty as well. Why is that? An inconsistently volatile difficulty curve. On normal, your opponents will either throw long-range attacks at you in unison or let you teabag them mercilessly in the corner. At least for the first island, anyway. On easy, they don't even try! Seriously, I've beaten rounds with my eyes closed, and I'm not exactly a gamer of great skill. Well, there's only one thing to do now. Kazam! Oh, wait. Never mind. So, Shaq finally reaches his basketball game, where he gets to commit mass genocide on the Japanese Olympic basketball team single-handedly. Unfortunately, he didn't realize that Beast was a blue-chip basketball prospect from Japan. And we just realized that we have just sat through one of the most fucked-up plots in video game history. I would rant about the poor fighting mechanics, the messed up plot, how Delphi and Software and EA sold out for just a few extra sales, and how the game rips off Street Fighter any chance it gets. But I'm not the type of guy who likes to scream into a microphone for no apparent reason other than to try and make himself look all tough and angry for an audience that doesn't like getting their eardrums raped by an 80 decibel onslaught of incomprehensible gabble. Or am I? And despite its shortcomings, this game is not as bad as everyone says it is. Yes, this game is crap, but it's not one of the worst games of all time. I can name five fighters for the Genesis alone that are worse than this. Balls, Rise of the Robots, Slaughter Sport, Heavy Nova, and Batman Forever. Yes, I consider Batman Forever to be a fighter. Besides, the game inspired this guy. Pwned! But just to make you people happy.
Alright, let's see what we got here. This is the first in many of a short review I plan to do. And this game is... The Tale of Faithful something... I can't remember the fucking lyrics. Shit! Alright, not the end of the world. 3-hour trip. Something. Okay, this is kind of dragging on a bit here. I know who the fucking cast of Gilligan's Island are! I like how they say professor, not the professor, just professor. Alright, that's enough of the fucking theme song! Episode 1, start. Start! Start, you motherfucker! Start! Damn it! Oh, Jesus! Now hear this, everyone! It looks like... What? Looks like what? Like someone shit in their pants? Like someone made the worst fucking dialogue ever? What? Tell me! Never mind. I've only heard things about this game. This is the first time I'm ever playing it. What the fuck? Death from above! Holy shit! The fuck, Rocks? Get into you in this game? The fuck is Gilligan doing? Oh my god. Please tell me this music does not loop. Oh shit, monkeys! Spank the monkey! Spank the fucking. What the fuck? What the hell? I was swinging directly at that damn. Fucking monkeys! Gilligan, what are you getting ass raped by a monkey now? The fuck is this? Bland sprite number one. We'll call him Professor. Mrs. Howell is with Mr. Howell. Thanks for the fucking update! Jesus Christ, if you wonder why I'm so pissed off, I had a bad day at work. Oh, this looks like fun. Spike, but... What the fuck?! Gilligan can't dodge a retarded monkey, but he can clear these fucking spikes?! Oh great, like this fat fuck doesn't move slow enough as is. The fuck?! What is that thing over there? A goddamn cheetah?! The fuck?! I was aiming right for him! There's more of the goddamn things! The fuck is that, half a glitched out? Oh look, it's a banana, kids! Or a glitch of a banana. What, are you fucking joking? How do I get out of this shit? Come on, there's gotta be something! You can't just be stuck for life! Okay, you gotta like, slam the fucking A button down repeatedly, over and over and over and over and over. Come on, you fat fuck, move your ass! Ugh. What the fuck, where did... Keep up with me, you skinny shrimp! What the fuck is this? Lovey. What the fuck is Lovey? I've watched every episode of Gilligan's Island, wait. I don't fucking remember, it's been too long. If anybody finds my ring, I'll give them a jar of Russia's finest caviar. I got it the way any capitalist would. I won it at a friendly poker game. Oh, ha ha ha, that was real amusing. Anybody catch the bottom screen yet? They're like saying random shit every 5 seconds. They never shut the fuck up. Come on, this is so stupid. The fuck, why do I have to keep slamming a fucking... I cannot believe that rocks can fucking injure you. And why does everything... I mean, Platoon looked all the same. I think this is worse. What did I just do, extend the time? Oh great, more death birds. Fucking boulders. Oh shit. Alright, this shouldn't be that difficult. Just jump. Oh my fuck. Fucking rock! Oh, that doesn't hurt though. The fuck? This hit detection. This game has like bar none the worst hit detection I've ever. The fuck? It wasn't even near me. Holy crap. On a pita! Let's hope I don't fall or, you know, break my fat ass open on these freaking rocks. I just touched the mouse and nothing happened. I don't even go near it and I fucking take a hit. Somebody want to explain to me what they were doing when they were supposed to program the game? Where did snakes come from? Where did the snakes come from? When I've heard... Oh my god, it's like he likes to walk right into things. Controls are absolutely terrible. You even tap down slightly as you're moving left or right, you just fly in that direction. What the hell are these, warthogs? This island is inhabited by every creature known to mankind, and they're all death to... Fucking the skipper, excuse me. Oh, great. Could you please move your ass, you fat fuck? Holy shit. What the fuck? Why is he up here? Keep up with me, you stupid ass. Let's go. And this beautiful scenery, skipper, just lovely. It will look better if something... The fuck? Come on, you asshole! Keep up! Oh my god! This is why this fat fuck shouldn't have been jumping in the first place. Let me ask you something. Whose bright idea was it to make a fucking video game based off Gilligan's Island? What kid has seen fucking Gilligan's Island? And no adult with a brain is gonna sit here and play this piece of shit. Oh my god, more fucking quicksand. Bash the A button. You gotta see my finger. It's literally gonna start to bleed soon if I gotta hit it anymore. Hurry up! Oh, my fucking voice. What the fuck? Look at this! Look at him climb the tree like a monkey! Holy shit! Now what? Skipper, I found something. I assume he's gonna say something. Why am I stuck? Got a really bad feeling. I wanna know why I can't move. The fuck? You're with me, alright? You're right up my ass. Any closer, your dick's probably up my crack. Come on, why the fuck do I have no controls? I don't believe this. I'm actually trying to play this fucking game, and it's giving me more reasons not to play it. Do some- Thank you, Christ, I have no idea what caused that. I doubt it's the game. Unless I never seen Nintendo games do- Actually, that's not true. Fuck it, moving on. We're on Gilligan's Island, here where we try to dodge rocks but fall down flat on our fucking asses! Har har har! Oh my god, Gilligan, you- I mean- Yeah, Gilligan, you stupid ass! I don't even want to take him with me. Nope, my timer has officially dropped down to, like, virtually nothing. Fuck Gilligan, I don't need these- Oh my god, I just extended this. This review is supposed to be 3.5 fucking minutes! Now it's going into, like, what, 7-8 minutes? This is so fucking bad, it's painful! Where the fuck do these stupid snap? Oh, great. More of these controls where if I even slightly tap down, I fly! I love how this fat fuck can't walk through quicksand, but if you move down, it's like vroom! Space rocket ship! Shroom! Holy shit, I'm supposed to be a fucking homage to Howard Neal, not complaining for half an hour. Does this game ever fucking end? Do I ever see level 2, episode 2? The fuck? Complete dead end? Holy crap on a pita. Oh my god! What the monkey fuck is this? Jump, you tub of something funny! I've run out of metaphors! I can't believe I'm still playing this! What the fuck is wrong with me? Snakes. Snakes. What, it'd have to be snakes? Cause snakes are fucking annoying! Indiana Jones' fat tub of shit ain't! I really got nothing! Gilligan's not with you? Gilligan's not with you? He's probably making a mess. Yeah, and his messes always mess me up. Har 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 har! Shut the fuck up! You're not funny! This game is like giving me the worst migraine of all time. This might be the game that's pissing me off the most of any game I've ever played in my life that I'm actually getting so fucking vocal I think my mic is about to break. Oh my god. Oh my god! Move! You fat fuck! I see people in wheelchairs move faster than this! I can break both my fucking legs and drag my ass halfway across the turnpike and make it home faster than you walk across 2 inches of fucking quick... whatever it is, quicksand, mud pits! And I'm back in this fucking hole again. Oh my god, it's worse than the pit and fucking Predator! Oh shit, man. Oh my... Wait a minute, I didn't fall in before, why the fuck? You gotta be- you can't be serious here, right? I guess so. You saw it, I bumped into that before nothing happened. Oh great, more animals that want to kill me. They must smell the meat! Gilligan, could you just walk in a straight line? I mean, the skipper, could you just walk in a straight line? Had a problem when I was a kid, I used to- What the fuck are you doing in the fucking quicksand?! What brain were you born with?! Now, I understand the skipper was kinda stupidish, but this is taking it to a level that's just beyond reality. This asshole can't keep up for 5 feet, and he walks into everything. Meanwhile, he can navigate the trickiest jumps without even fucking thinking about it! Christ! I cannot believe I'm still fucking reviewing this. Screw it, I'm gonna play it so it fucking... It'll probably kill me! I'll go out in a bang. Fuck it. Gilligan's Island could be the game that broke Armake 21. See what I mean? He walks to everything. Every goddamn fucking thing he walks into. Oh my god. Gilligan, you fucking idiot! Keep the fuck up! Ugh! I can't take this shit! You're a moron! You and your fucking striped shirt! Go climb a tree, you friggin' monkey-ass reject! I would love to see him climb another tree. That would just make me laugh my ass off. Why can't I punch Gilligan? That would be fun. Could punch Roger and Robert Roger Rabbit, excuse me. Robert Rabbit. Oh my god. Gilligan, what the fuck are you doing? Masturbating behind the scenes? What are you doing that you can't keep- Oh god, the rocks of death. This is a blast from the past. I played another shitty Nintendo game like this at one time. Probably the same company made it. The fuck? Every bird, man. Gilligan is a fucking bird maggot. Toucan. Oh my god. Toucans! I knew I recognized these fuckers. These are the same ones that haunted my ass in fucking Line of Shithead. They're back with a vengeance, people. I think. I don't know. Wow. I'm actually tired from yelling at this point. And I'm still fucking playing. With 5 minutes to go. This is ridiculous. And have you noticed that it's the same fucking music? It's like a 30-second ditty that just keeps looping. That's what my brain hears like. It's like someone took an electric fucking drill and shoved it in the side of my temple and just went. How's it feel, man? Alright, mate, let's drill a little harder. Would you like to play Deadly Towers while you're fucking at it? How about Treasure Master? We'll just serve up a side order of complete and utter fucking shit in video game format. Cause we are game developers. We got paid to make this piece of shit. I gotta bust my ass to make fucking $800, $900 every 2 weeks. These fucking assholes must have made $1 billion off this pile of shit. Check it out, kids. More dialogue. Hal, here's a jar of Hal's finest caviar.
I heard a ghastly sound over by the professor.
Who cares? I certainly fucking don't. Great, here's more fucking quicksand. Move, goddamn you! Oh my god, now there's fucking mud! Could this be any slower? I love it, I love it. Oh my god, look at that fucking... Oh my... I can't even say it. I feel bad for even bringing God up in this. If I was God, I'd stay the fuck away from this game. More birds of death. I can't win. What the fuck? This game is fucking horrible! I went to a fucking dead end again! What are you, joking? Oh, you cannot fucking be serious! Oh my god. That's it? Game over, kids! Sorry, but you just oh my- The fuck? Shut up! It's like my head don't hurt enough! Shut up, goddammit! Fucking score count! Game fucking sucks! Don't ever fucking play it! Unless you want to die a slow and painful death! The next reviews will be a hell of a lot shorter than this, but this is what happens when good ideas go very fucking wrong! See ya!
Sonic Man, you used to be so cool. I mean, really cool. I mean, we grew up together and we had so many fun times. I had your comic books, I had your children's books, I had 1, 2, 3 of your chapter books, I had all your games. I mean, I've even got this little demo CD that had Sonic CD on it for a computer. God, what happened to you, man? I mean, you've got good Game Boy Advance and DS games, but I have these. I don't need any more handhelds. And then there's this. Shadow the Hedgehog for PlayStation 2, Xbox, and GameCube. If you've already played a three-dimensional Sonic game before, you don't need me to tell you that this game probably sucks. Let's pretend for argument's sake you don't know much about Sonic the Hedgehog. Now what do you think when you see Shadow the Hedgehog? He's black, he's bald, however he does not look like a bitch. Actually, he's more of a sad attempt by Sega to make the Shadow character seem a lot more edgy and extreme. You know, little kids, they like extreme things like extreme Yu-Gi-Oh! And extreme Beyblade. I don't fucking know. I haven't been a kid for like 20 years. Anyway, the game starts off simple enough. Shadow standing in the middle of the field and can't remember dick all except his name.
Shadow the Hedgehog. Why does that name haunt me? It's the only thing I can remember.
Oh, don't take it too hard, Shadow. You still remember how to eat, sleep, and suck. Anyway, the shit hits the fan, and Dr. Claw tells Shadow that he can tell him exactly who he is, but he's got to get him all 7 Chaos Emeralds in order to do it.
Find the seven Chaos Emeralds and bring them to me as promised.
If he says he knows the truth about who I am, then like it or not, I have to believe him.
What? No, you don't. What if he's just lying to get the emeralds from you? God, how can the ultimate life form be so fucking stupid? Oh, before we go anywhere, we have to determine which version of Shadow the Hedgehog is right for you. If you like your Shadow the Hedgehog to have a lousy frame rate every now and then, you should go with the PlayStation 2 version. If you like your Shadow to have even worse controls, worse camera, and the inability to control the second player, you should go with the Xbox version. And if you've got a GameCube, well, you've already got Sonic Adventure 1 and 2, you may as well finish the set. Anyway, you always start out in Westopolis. Did you forget that already?
Westopolis, Westopolis, and Westopolis.
He just loves to say Westopolis. Westopolis, 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 Westopolis. For those of you playing the home game, say that over and over until the words have lost all meaning. Not far into the level, you'll meet up with this familiar-looking guy.
Long time no see! Looks like these black creatures really mean business. Let's you and me show them a thing or two.
Sonic will play the role of Player 2, much like Tails used to do in Sonic 2 and 3. Except in each level, you have two different Player 2s to choose from. You see, there are three different ways to do a level. The neutral way, which is to just do the bare minimum, the good way, and the evil way. This would be okay if the Player 2 characters weren't constantly trying to change the objective you're trying to accomplish. If you're working for Sonic and then the Doomsday guy decides he wants you to do his thing, you have to switch back to Sonic in order to keep doing the good objective. The whole objective thing was a nice idea, but it's executed poorly. It slows down the gameplay and then it compounds the other problems that Sonic games in 3D have already had. So instead of running really fast from one end of the level to the other, which seemed to work just fine for every other Sonic game, you now have to run around, argue with the camera, and kill X number of enemies strewn throughout the entire level. And if you miss one, you gotta run all the way back and get it again. Oh god, cars. Okay, this is the part of the game I like to call, if it looks really good in an FMV, you can't do it. You see this really cool looking move? No, you're not doing that in the game. Deflecting bullets that people shoot at you? No, you're not doing that either. Sega oversells the character. Like other cool people, Shadow can kick ass and take names, but unfortunately, much like Vincent Valentine and Albert Wesker, once you get to controlling them, they can't do shit. And if he's the ultimate life form, why does he need guns and cars? It's like they forgot who he was, and then they just turned him into this extreme guy that everybody's supposed to love because he's so extreme and edgy with the guns and the cars. You know what? Let's get off the first level.
Hey, Shadow! You saw him too, didn't you? Those black creatures floating around here? Time to clean house and do a little exterminating. Get rid of these annoying aliens. Get rid of these annoying aliens. Get rid of these annoying aliens!
I'm sorry, why does Knuckles sound like a New Yorker with a hint of Waka?
I became a guardian to fight sin, yeah?
Still, he's better than this partner.
Oh, Shadow, I'm so glad you're here. Queen went into this weird-looking castle and she hasn't come back out. Will you go in there with me to look for her?
Anyway, yeah, the controls aren't, good. Would you fucking get down from there, Tumorhead? If I'd honestly known that my favorite character from my childhood was gonna degenerate into this, I would've taken up another hobby. What goddamn member of Sonic Team woke up in the morning and thought this was a good idea? Weapons are useless. All you ever do is hit the A button to jump, hit the A button again to attack, but then you go and you miss, and then you die. Damn. The partner characters are always fighting over whose sets of objectives you're doing. Why can't they just both be displayed on the screen? There's plenty of room. When you get hit, though, you only lose 10 rings, and that's like the game. It's like the people who made the game admitting, you know what? We fucked up. You get hit way too often. Let's make it so you can get hit a little more often before you die. And let's make Shadow so stupid that he doesn't question when Robotnik says he's an android. I mean, shouldn't you cut yourself open just to check, like he did in Terminator 2? How fucking stupid are you? The only good thing about this game is it's non-linear. So you can go through all the levels really slow, deal with all the characters bitching at each other about whose sets of objectives you're doing, and then get them done, and then you can go to the next level, they can argue, bitch, moan, and some more. The game has about 11 different endings, which is about 10 more times than I'm willing to play through the game. There's some levels, there's somewhere he takes over Robotnik's armory, there's some where he takes over the world, there's some where he's a nice guy, I don't fuck here. You wanna know? You know what? Go look at Wikipedia. They're all listed right there. And you know what? They're not really well descriptive, but you know what? That's just all the endings are. It's, I am Shadow the Hedgehog. I have 7 emeralds. I have a fork up my ass. And I'm trying to fill a quota. There are a lot more things I was going to talk about, but you know what? I can't fucking take it anymore. Oh, Sonic, meet me out in the backyard. I got a present for you.
It was a cold December morn when at my PC did I sit. I decided to review Daze Before Christmas. What a piece of shit. With gameplay that sucks and music so lame. Just who the hell thought this was a good idea for a game? You play as Saint Nick, that jolly fat elf. After playing this thing, I wanted to punch myself. You know what? Screw all this poetry shit. Let's just get down to business. Man, that was bad. Yes, I am reviewing the Daze Before Christmas, a piece of Yuletide joy from the good people at Sunsoft. And, as my pitiful poem at the start there stated, this game really does suck reindeer dick. First, let me attempt to set the stage for all of you. It seems that some goon named Timekeeper and his evil snowman henchman stole some plans that Santa had. Exactly what these plans are is never really explained, but I don't think it would have helped much. And the final sentence of this thing really doesn't help matters any. Gonna play rough, huh? Wow. So I guess Santa's some kind of an S&M-loving freak, isn't he? I think I actually saw that somewhere before. I think it was in a comic book once that starred the Ultimate Warrior. You know, guys, the pro wrestler. Whoa, wait a minute. That Santa wasn't really into S&M. Warrior just stole the jolly fat man's clothes and forced him into bondage. Oh, come on. That image cannot be that disturbing, can it? I guess it is pretty damn disturbing. Get that off the screen, please. Thank you. I didn't mean to get off track there, kids. It hopefully won't happen again. And if the result's always that horrible Santa in chains picture, I will never jump off track again. Let's get back to the review. Graphics-wise, the game is pretty good. It honestly is nothing to really write home about, but it is good for an SNES game. The sound, on the other hand, is just painful. Why don't you guys just, like, give this a listen? Now, I may not be a big fan of Christmas music, but I do know what I like, and I don't like this. Hell, I will go on a limb and say I flat out hate this music. It's fucking headache-inducing, and it's not fit to be played over the speakers at a fucking Kmart. Control is a little sticky and occasionally unresponsive. Everything seems to be delayed by about an eighth of a second, and this is really gonna fuck you up, and it is gonna lead to occasional death. Also, this game's draw distance is, at times, painful. In some levels, being this close isn't too bad, because you don't have to worry about falling to an untimely death. But there are points where not being able to see a little further ahead will lead to cheap death. And with the game itself being so fucking easy, cheap death is about the only kind you will ever experience. Oh yes, this game is very easy. In fact, I would hazard a guess that it's almost too easy. And the game is boring, too. I've had more fun watching Snowfall. Now, let me tell you how the game itself is laid out. It's simple platforming, with the occasional cheap falling death, since you can't see more than a few feet ahead of yourself. Then, you have to fight a very easy boss battle. Just look at this shit. I don't even have to fucking duck. I just keep on shooting, and this snowy bastard takes it like a little bitch. And after beating this pitiful, giant, evil snowman, you get to bomb a country. You get to deliver presents. You know which children have been good, because their chimneys are smoking. So I guess that their presents just burn in the fireplace while the family sleeps. Do you see that pile of ash there, kids? Merry fucking Christmas. Then you start all over with more dull platforming. And to help spice things up, if you hit a cup of hot chocolate, at least I think it's a cup of hot chocolate, you become anti-Santa, or some such stupid shit. And all this is a form of invincibility. And you can't do as much as you can as regular Santa. You cannot collect health, extra lives, or anything else. So this little feature is mostly worthless. But the only plus to it is that the music in the background is pretty good. Give it a listen. Sure, honestly, it's not going to win a Grammy, but it's a lot better than the rest of the music in this horrible thing. And now I have a big question for everybody. Exactly how long will someone play a Christmas-based game? My guess is between December 1st and January 3rd. After that, it will just collect dust until about next December. Then, if you find it in your closet, the horrible memories will hit you like a Vietnam flashback, and you'll probably throw the horrible thing in the fireplace with the pile of ash that used to be your present from Santa. So, in closing, avoid this game. If you really want to experience something crappy this Christmas, find a copy of the Star Wars Holiday Special. You can normally find them on eBay pretty cheap. Sure, yeah, it sucks, but it's so bad, it's funny. And speaking of so bad, it's funny. Muttley, why don't we give our viewers some good old-fashioned Christmas cheer?
The name sucks ass, but don't stop booing. I'm not a rip-off, I'm just reviewing some shitty games that'll make you puke and gag. Beatles, Angry Beauty.
What the hell? These fucking songs suck. Who the fuck listens to theme songs anyway? Fuck this! Alright, let's... Beatles, Angry Video Game Fag! Da-na-na-na-na-na-na! Wee-wee! Cool sounds and shit. Whoa.
First, there was no universe and no actual time and space continuum. Then there were game shows! Let's talk about them. Now, there are lots of game shows. Some good, some bad. Some game shows with trivia questions, like Jeopardy, for example, are kind of intriguing and pretty much lets you participate right where you're sitting on your ass in the couch.
Untamed Man for $500, please.
Irish writer born in 1854 was one of the most successful playwrights of late Victorian London.
You scream, Oscar Wilde! I know this one, it's Oscar Wilde! And your roommate, girlfriend, or mom, or whatever, says, you didn't phrase it as a question. You fail. Who was Oscar Wilde? I win. And then you say,
fuck you!
And run to the bathroom and masturbate while you're crying. We've all been there. Then there are game shows without the quiz stuff, but with awesome shit like people beating each other up, getting drenched in goo, and hurting themselves really bad. Shows like the Japanese cult classic Takeshi's Castle. They're fucking great as well, even without the pop quiz. But forget all about engaging quiz shows and awesome stunt shows, because right now, I'm going to talk about a show called Deal or No Deal. If you're blessed enough to live in a country where Deal or No Deal is not on TV, or if you just successfully avoided it, a quick lesson of how it works. There's a host, a banker, a contestant and his three helpers, and a gang of miserable people sitting around feeling screwed known as the audience. Then there's also 26, quote, models, unquote, in the usual sexist let's get puberal 12-year-old viewers by showing tits and ass banner, who stand around with numbered briefcases containing everything between $0.01 and $1 million. The contestant picks out a case that is his or hers, and then starts opening cases a couple at a time. If a case contains, for example, $75,000, then that means that number is not in the contestant's case and is removed from the scoreboard. Every now and then, between opening random cases, the banker will give the contestant an offer, something along the lines of, I give you $50,000 for your case. The contestant will then say no deal, the audience goes, yay, because the contestant is so brave and continues to open cases, and finally there are just two cases left. If the contestant chooses the right case, they're
yeah.
Rich. If not, they just go back to their trailer park and continue to hate life. Most game shows, no matter how ass and boring they are, have some element of competition that makes you want to watch it. A reason you're not googling for hentai, but wasting your life sitting in front of the TV instead. Deal or No Deal is not like most game shows. It's what I'd like to call a what-the-fuck-ever show. And watching it is like watching a curling match between Poland and the Czech Republic. You don't give a single drip of shit about who wins, and there's nothing fun about just watching it since nothing ever happens, and generally watching curling is about as fun as being raped by angry Scotsmen.
How'd you like me haggis, laddie?
A curling match, however, between 50 naked Brazilian supermodels and 3 dozens of big-ass snakes with the ice replaced by mud and whipped cream complete with some bastard throwing water balloons everywhere and the rules of curling only consisting of get yourself muddy, lol, and then sold down to a soundtrack consisting of heavy metal classics and 8-bit video game music while Alistair Beck's in a chicken suit riding a monster truck that can fly, screaming trivia clues about Oscar Wilde. That'd be entertainment. Unfortunately, nobody understands my simple logic, so we're all stuck watching gut-wrenching ass pies like Deal or No Deal. So we've established that the TV show is a rotting piece of shit. But if you want to make as much money as possible, and we all know that's what the TV producers want, you take your show and sell it in the shape of other medias. So, what can you do with a show that involves no question of knowledge, reaction time, speed, technique, wit, logic, thought, or anything else but just sheer randomness and luck? Well, the only reasonable answer, apparently, is to turn it into a... wait for it? You already know what it is, so fuck it, but yeah, wait for it. Video game. I guess the show producers went out to find a company that could as cheaply as humanly possible make a game based on their piece of shit show. Some child molesting, granny raping video game company called Global Star Software decided to take this offer on. They spent, and now I'm just guessing, about 2 days, coffee breaks included, to create the Deal or No Deal game. And this is the result. Deal or No Deal was released in November 2006 for the PC, Nintendo DS, and Game Boy Advance. This changed the world. No, it didn't. It just really sucked ass. Let's take a look at this wonder of gaming. And we're off. This looks like a really great game. So far, it's been awesome. Oh man, everything's taking a turn for the worse. What is this? What's this? End them all? That sounds like some kind of toothpaste. Okay, come on, get on with it. Cat Daddy Games. Yeah. So far it's been... oh, man. Oh, man, it... aw, shit.
What's happening to me?
Enter the Angry Video Game Bag.
Well, look at that. All it took was the title screen. I feel the power rushing through my veins fuck. Alright, let's just get on with the game.
I guess the only reasonable thing to do in the beginning of starting up the fucking game is to go to the single player mode. Start the TV game like this, and first off, you choose your helpers. And the variety of people here are pretty awesome. You got this weird guy. You got Marv from Sin City. You got the creepy Eli Wood guy from Sin City. The guy who eats people. You got Socrates. You got Abe Lincoln without the hat. You got some mongoloid bastard. You got this punk rocker piece of shit. You got this fucking idiot with some motorix problem, some dude trying to suck a cock but there's no cock, some fucking cowboy, some praying bastard, another guy trying to suck a cock that's not there, some Armenian guy. The iPod guy. Some fucker. Some dude with a stick. A fucking dog. Alright, let's go with Marv, and let's see. Ah, the females, you got iPod bitch, that's great. You got some old creepy bitch. You got some, what the fuck? You got another iPod bitch, or something. Oh, look at that creepy hand, that's creepy. You got, dog. Bitch poking her eyes out. Stereotypically African bitch, some old bitch, an even older bitch, some ponytail bitch, some pregnant bitch. Alright, I got Marv, the creepy mongoloid, and that guy. Girl. Thing. Who gives a shit? Let's start this
piece of crap.
Hello and welcome to Deal or No Deal.
Thank you.
I'm Howie Mandel, and this evening you could walk away with a huge cash prize.
Oh, really? Do that, I thought I couldn't do that because this is just a simple fucking video game!
Great sense of timing. Now I think it's time I introduce you to my better half. Actually, 26 of my better halves.
Oh, ladies, humor!
Please.
Get on with it. Hey, what's this? What's going on? Oh my god! Oh my god! It's the invasion of the army of plastic whores! Everybody run! This is not a drill! They are coming to eat us alive and puke us up by putting toothbrush in their mouth! Alright. No.
We don't know what is in each of these 26
cases. Let's listen to Baldy here.
We do know that the biggest prize amount in one of these cases is $1 million.
Since we've already got all this explained to
us, $1 million.
Why do we care?
All the way down.
Fuck this.
One penny. Those are the different amounts. In each case, holds one of.
Something I gotta mention is that the game is actually pretty generous when it comes to letting you click stuff away.
Think of a number.
Like skip shit. And you're gonna love the game for that, because you are gonna want to skip the game. So it's good that you can actually skip all these video sequences. And the game consists of sequences only. Let's take number 6. Why not? Who cares? Nothing matters. Alright, 6 cases more. Which one should I take? Maybe I should take some. Give me my lucky number. Or something else. Or not just give a fuck about it. Alright, let's see, come on. $1,000! Thank you, plastic whore! I love that! Give me more, give me more! Give me everything! Okay, whatever, come on, get on with it.
Number 18, that's Cassidy.
There's no point to this! $75! Yee! Big winner! Alright, you already know how this works, right? I'm just opening cases. So far, the game is going pretty good on me, which is nice.
Number 5.
Let's go with 5 here.
Come on, let's see the.
Come on, open it, you Asian slut. Get on with it! Ah, $300! That's awesome! No, I want a $300. If this game could give me $300, that would be so great. Okay, let's see. $50! I got the money back I paid for this stinking piece of shit game. Yay! Except I didn't because I don't get the money. That's fuck this. $200. Hooray. Okay.
You have one more case. Number 17. Let's see a low amount.
Open the case, you plastic bitch. Oh, and there you go. The $1 million are gone. There's no way to win $1 million now. The $1 million are gone, so you can't really complete the game or whatever. You can only walk away with less money than that. Why would you keep playing? You might as well just start over again. If you really want money, I mean, you're not getting the money, so it doesn't matter.
He's not your friend.
I mean, goddamn. This game shouldn't be called Deal or No Deal. It should be called What's the Deal with this fucking game? I don't understand. I don't understand why anyone would buy this. How come? I mean, there's no gameplay in it. There's nothing at all. You're just clicking random shit, hoping for everything to get good. It's like you're just randomly pressing a button, and it says, yeah, you won $50,000. Or, yeah, you won the million. Go you. Whoa. There's no gameplay. And that's kind of their tagline. That's what they're selling this shit based on. No stunts. No trivia questions. Just cases. What the fuck? It's like you're selling a car and like, yeah, you can't drive it. And it sucks ass. And there are these shitty German Wunderbaums all over the place. The fuck? I mean, someone fucked up. They fucked up when they came up with the whole idea to the show, and they fucked up when they decided to make a fucking video game based on it. There's not a Fear Factor video game. That would include some crappy minigames. There are no crappy minigames in here. Oh wait, yes there is. Let's just fuck this game and go check out the minigames. I guess they really understood they couldn't just sell a game with only that case opening part. So, they
slapped on the shittiest piece of crap minigames I've ever seen. Let's take a look at him. Five Case Monte.
Okay, Monte, welcome to Five Monte, Case Monte.
Okay, the $1 million to right there.
$1 million. Once you found it, keep
so,
your eye on it.
Yeah,
remember,
this is it.
Round,
whoa,
got it.
I found the dollars. $1 million. Go me. Whoa, I found him again.
Now keep your eye on it.
Yay. It's not like the guy's going to give me a sacred key to some lair somewhere where I can slay monsters and become a hero.
Ready to move on?
You know, this sucks so much ass. All right, let's play it. Let's just play. Let's have fun. On you, motherfucker. Anyway, next minigame.
Welcome to the puzzle game. Here's
oh, I remember how I just loved to play these kinds of puzzles. Fuck you, you disgusting piece of shit gaming, you asshole developers that understand shit about games, and I'll fuck you with the ass! And last, and definitely the least entertaining of them all, the memory challenge. Yeah, you read that right, memory. It's a fucking memory game. It's just playing memory. What on earth were they thinking? When they thought anyone would actually pay money to play memory? You could make these fucking games at home. You got shitloads of them. They're freebies, goddammit. This game is so fucking bad. This game is so fucking ass. I don't understand. It's fucking inconceivably bad. I'm the fucking... This is all! I showed you everything there is to it! Every fucking part of the game has been explored! What the fuck?! Oh, yeah, you might wonder how I did on the TV game, by the way. Yeah, let's take a look at that. It came down to whether I wanted number 6 or the remaining one up there on the stage. The amounts remaining were 5 grand and a penny. You might actually just guess right now which one I took. I decided to keep the number 6. Let's take a look inside.
Let's see what's in your case. Not a bad deal. Not the best, but you could have done much worse.
Not a bad deal? Not the best one, but you could have done much worse? How the fuck could that be? Were you gonna fucking rob me? Well, you have! You have robbed me of my sanity and of my pride with this fucking game! Is this what video gaming has come to? Through all the years of development, this is what happens at the end. This is the end station. This is it. Deal or no fucking deal. What the fuck? It's regurgitating. It's creepy. It's really fucking scary. What the fuck did they do? What the fuck? You could have done much worse. You couldn't have done much worse. Goatsy Suckass Studios or whatever the fuck your name is. You could not have done much worse. You couldn't have done worse anything. You couldn't have made a game that's crappier than this. Well, you haven't even made a crappy game because this is not a game. This is nothing. This is shit. You could play this in a fucking Flash player on the internet. For free. But they're selling it. On 3 different platforms. Yeah, it's for the Advance and for the Nintendo DS as well. So you can take it with you wherever you go. Show your friends. Show strange people on the bus. Show everyone your wonderful game. What the fuck were they thinking? This is an insult. This game is a fucking insult. This game is a fucking piece of shit. The fuck?
I played a lot of games, some good, some bad, and some underrated. But out of all the games I've played, I have never seen a bigger hatred of a game than Sonic the Hedgehog, the game that celebrated the 15th anniversary of the Sonic series. My question is it really as bad as everybody says, or is there a hidden gem? Well, let's see what I think. Let's take a look.
I'm Sonic! Sonic the Hedgehog!
Not that irritating hedgehog again! Attack!
The The game is divided in three separate storylines that tie in to each other. Sonic's story, Shadow's story, and Silver's story. I'll begin with Sonic's. It's the Festival of the Sun in the beautiful Soliana, where it's hosted by Princess Elise. The festivities get interrupted by Dr. Eggman as he wishes to attain the secrets of the Flames of Disaster, but Sonic interferes and saves Elise, only for her to get kidnapped, but she ends up giving Sonic her Chaos Emerald. So with the help of Tails and Knuckles, Sonic not only has to stop Eggman from getting the secrets and take over the world, but also save Elise in the process.
Wow, that's a pretty snazzy performance there!
Shadow's story involves the Black Hedgehog now working for GUN. For those who haven't played the expert mode of Shadow the Hedgehog won't know why this happens. Is sent on a mission to rescue a missing agent in White Acropolis. The missing agent turns out to be Rouge the Bat as she is sent to retrieve an item known as the Scepter of Darkness. Arriving at the GUN rendezvous point, they are confronted by Eggman. Eggman foolishly punches Rouge, causing her to drop the scepter, which shatters and releases a being known as Mephiles.
Oh, how ironic fate can be.
So it's up to Shadow and Rouge, along with the help of Omega, needs to find out who is Mephiles and what is his ultimate plan.
Mephiles? Who is he?
Then we got the new character, Silver the Hedgehog. Silver's story involves Silver, where he lives in a world that is devastated by a creature known as Iblis. With the help of Blaze the Cat, they find and defeat Iblis again. But Silver is frustrated with the fact that Iblis will regenerate, and the cycle will continue. But they are confronted by Mephiles, who tells them in order to change the future, they must go back in time to find the one who will unleash Iblis.
But that's impossible!
With my help, you can. Because I have the power to travel through time.
No way!
A sinister Mephiles fools Silver to believe that Sonic is the Iblis trigger.
I see it! So that blue hedgehog's the Iblis trigger?
Blue hedgehog.
Mephiles sends Silver and Blaze back in time to when Sonic was alive so Silver can kill Sonic. Silver also encounters Amy as she learns that Silver and her are looking for somebody and helps him find the person he's looking for, and vice versa. Now, I know what they were trying to do. Create a plotline that was so epic it could be rival to any action movie. Or hell, even Jack 2. But my problem with the plot is that the plot isn't tied down entirely. That it can feel like it goes all over the place. It seems that Spider-Man 3 actually did a better job at tying plot lines down so well to make an epic plot. But in regards, the story isn't the best I've seen in a video game, but definitely not the worst.
There's no strength in numbers.
Like the story, the gameplay is divided into three parts: Sonic, Shadow, and Silver. Sonic's gameplay plays similar to the previous Sonic games, even back to the days of the Sega Genesis, with Sonic running from point A to point B, collecting rings, defeating enemies, etc. But there are some things that are added. First off is the Mach Speed sections, where Sonic runs incredibly fast and it's your job to avoid obstacles. There are times where Sonic will have to escort Elise in a level, in which Elise has the power to create a barrier around her and Sonic that allows them to walk over dangerous substances. Shadow's gameplay has some similarities, but yet it is different. Even with the speedy sections, Shadow is based more on combat. Like Sonic, Shadow can slide and do the homing attack, but Shadow has different Chaos abilities, including Chaos Spear, which is the very first time used in Shadow's gameplay. The only other time it was used is in the final boss of Shadow the Hedgehog. When the gauge is filled, Shadow can unleash Chaos Boost, which increases his attack and unleashes more Chaos powers, including Chaos Blast, which returns from Shadow the Hedgehog. Like Shadow the Hedgehog, Shadow can drive vehicles, in which some levels are mandatory, and actually they prove to be more useful than Shadow the Hedgehog. They also come with rocket launchers and machine guns. That's just awesome. Silver's gameplay is completely different from Sonic and Shadow. The main gimmick of Silver is his psychokinesis abilities. Silver is slower than Sonic and Shadow, so platforming and puzzle solving plays a bigger factor in his gameplay. Silver can float in the air, pick up objects, and using them as weapons. He can also temporarily paralyze his enemies and take control of them. Personally, I really love Silver's gameplay as it brings a new variety into the game. But my favorite probably would have to go to Shadow, as his chaos abilities were so much fun to use. At certain points, the game will switch to an amigo character that helps the three hedgehogs. Sonic has Tails, who can fly and attack with dummy ring bombs, which are more effective than Sonic Heroes. Not to mention, he can also snipe dummy ring bombs as well, and Knuckles, who can glide and attack with his fists. Shadow has Rouge, who like Knuckles can glide, and like Tails, can attack and snipe bombs, and Omega, who can fire different missiles and use his jets to glide. Silver has Blaze, who can run just as fast as Sonic, and uses her fire abilities to fight. And Amy, who can use her hammer to attack, has the ability to double jump, which in my opinion is probably the best thing about Amy's gameplay, let alone from a Sonic game, and also has the ability to turn invisible? Wait a minute! Since when does Amy can turn invisible? What is she, a chameleon? I fucking sue her ass. Anyways, Wild's Amy has her hammer to attack, but doing this will make her vulnerable. She isn't my least favorite though. That honor goes to Knuckles. His attacks prove to have a problem that if you make a mistake, then you're screwed. This game has the same problem that previous Sonic games have. Trial and error. And there's a lot of it. Mostly in Sonic's gameplay. Most notably, the Mach Speed sections. Where if you make one mistake and you will get screwed. And this is true in Crisis City. But personally, I don't think it's as bad as Jack 2. As I didn't want to throw the controller all over the place and went on a Hulk-like rampage. So that's a good thing. The bosses were very fun, as they require a special method to beat them, not just beating them in a fast time. And not to mention, they weren't frustrating at all. My personal favorites with each hedgehog were Egg Wyvern with Sonic, Mephiles with Shadow, and Iblis' Phase 3 with Silver. The one final thing is the hub world. Sonic, Shadow, and Silver all explore Solliana, and can even perform town missions. These can range from really fun, like fighting enemies, to really dumb, like who's the captain. By completing levels and town missions, you earn rings depending on how high you rank, and you can use them to purchase upgrades, like Sonic's Bounce Bracelet, Shadow's Chaos Boost moves, and Silver's special Psychokinesis attacks, by going to the shop. This, to me, is a welcome addition as it gives adventure to the feeling of the game, and not just, like, goes from one level to the next. I won't say anything about the load times and glitches, since everybody's said about it. But the camera can be a problem. As to me, it's not up to par. There are times where there's action, but you can't get the camera to get to the right angle. Then there are times where you miss some things you can't see from the current angle. And then there were times where it just passes out all over the place, most notably when you are jumping and you're hitting the ceiling. But with all of that, the gameplay still turned out to be rather good. If you can get past the load times, glitches, camera issues, and the annoying trial and error.
Piece of cake! No sweat!
This game doesn't show the full capabilities of the PlayStation 3 or Xbox 360, but the game still looks really good and shows a lot of depth to them. Each level is designed well and were a blast to go through. Some levels like Wave Ocean reminded me a lot of Seaside Hill from Sonic Heroes, and Crisis City reminded me a lot of Westopolis from Shadow the Hedgehog. The cutscenes also does a great job of the lip syncing, a thing that previous Sonic games had a problem with.
Who are you? And how do you know my name?
But the opening cutscenes were awesome, as the details were spot on and were good enough to be a rival to Pixar and DreamWorks. However, the frame rate can drop sometimes and epic slowdowns can happen. But even with that, I still thought that the designs of this game were really good.
Let's get moving!
If there was one thing that Sonic games never failed on, and that's music. And boy, does this game have a tremendous soundtrack. All the tunes were very fitting to the levels and were really catchy. There were some that were really soothing and relaxing. And there are tunes that are really epic and give some tensions, even in the boss fights. The main themes, His World, All Hail Shadow, and Dreams of an Absolution were also really catchy and very enjoyable to listen to. Certainly better than some of the other crap that I've heard. The sounds themselves are the same as before, but the only things that are different are the jump sound effects and the sound effects when you go through dash panels. Now, I personally like the four kids' voice actors, but most of the performances in this game were just average. The biggest problem was that there was a lack of emotion in some parts.
I'll make sure to change Elise's fate. And that in turn, should change your future too.
But with the average performances, there were still some really good performances.
My assignment was to rescue you, nothing more.
It's no use! Pull back! Pull back! Pull back!
What you gave to me, I now return to you. A one-way ticket to oblivion.
Also, Princess Elise was voiced by Hollywood actress Lacey Chabert, who turns out to be a lifelong Sonic fan.
I remember the first thing I bought with, like, my allowance. I saved it all up, and I bought the Game Gear system, and I bought Sonic. And I played it till the buttons broke off. I loved it.
And to be honest, she did a great job, making Elise confident but yet concerned.
It's all right. We give thanks for the blessed flames. May we always continue to have peace. Son of Soliana, guide and watch over us with your eternal light.
So the music is tremendous, the sound, well, good, and the voices, average.
If you thought you knew Blue, it's time to think faster.
All right, let's do it.
Now, do I think Sonic Next Gen is a terrible and one of the worst games ever made, let alone the last 10 years? The answer is no, not even close. Sonic Next Gen, I think, is a really decent game. Even though the game was rushed and it has a poor camera and consistent load times, and its fair share of glitches, I still enjoy it for what it has to offer. I guess you could say Sonic Next Gen is one of my guilty pleasures, and I'm not afraid to say that I liked it. And in my honest opinion, it is miles better than Sonic Heroes. So for this game, I say give this one a rent, but proceed with caution. And so my rating for Sonic Next Gen is... ...7.7 out of 10.